Wow, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Live at the Whiskey Lounge, another record-breaking crowd here. This is unbelievable. I appreciate every single one of you. Thank you. My name is Steve Rashid. I'm your host for the evening, and I see some familiar faces and some people I don't think have been here. How many people have never been here before? Oh, look at that. Fantastic. Well, you've never been here, so you may not know this. We do begin every evening with telling life's most embarrassing moment. And ma'am, since you're closest, if you would... No, I'm just kidding. This is it? This is it right now. No, thank you. If you have been here before, thank you for your continued support of this series. If you're brand new here, thank you for giving us a chance and supporting live music here in Evanston. This really does mean the world to us. We believe it or not, this is how we make our living, making music. I am myself a musician, and I was performing on the stage downstairs a little over a year ago, and this was a new venue. And I came upstairs and saw this beautiful room, and they hadn't completely figured out what they were going to do with this part of the venue. So I approached the management and said, would you be up for a jazz series here? And they said yes. So over a year later, where this is, I've kind of lost track, 62nd or 63rd show we've done here now. We're here nearly every Thursday. And the whole idea is small group jazz, duets, trios. This room at peak seats about 70 people, and I think we're probably about there now. So you can tell it's an intimate little room. And I think of these as little concerts. This is really a listening room. And I say that partly because that's how I feel and partly to ask your indulgence in that. We do, people are really here to listen to the music. So we do appreciate your kind attention when the musicians are playing. In addition, you see what looks like a lot of superfluous technology here. It is not. These microphones are here because not just to bring the sound to you. It really doesn't need it in this room so much. It's mostly because I bring a live audio rig here, and we do a live multi-track recording of every single show that is archived and is used. Musicians are able to use it for their purposes, for their promotional purposes if they like, and we keep an archive of it, and I don't do anything with those recordings without the musician's permission. I will tell you that we have started. We are in partnership with WDCB, the great jazz station here in Chicago, and we've started an actual radio show of this concert series. So, and last night was a premiere episode. We don't broadcast live from here, but we do take some select shows and then edit them down to 1 hour broadcast and broadcast them. So that started last night. It will be about once every month. But we do this recording, and it's kind of an exciting thing for all of us to be part of a live recording at every one of these shows. In addition, you see these little guys. These are cameras, and there are 5 cameras dotted around here, and we do a live stream of every single show. So we love it when you're here, and thank you for coming out in such great numbers. If you can't be here on a particular week and want to see what's going on, if you're in another location or have friends in another location, tell them about it. Take these little cards with you. It gives you information about it. There's a simple website. My name is Steve Rashid. It's steverashidpresents.com. If you go there, I didn't get my iPad up in time, but usually I hold it up and see, so you can see that we're actually streaming right now as I speak. Hi, everybody. So we do these live streams, and afterwards the shows are archived, so you can view them on the website and go back and view the past shows. So that's my sales pitch about the series. You can see, take these cards with you. It gives you the next, at least, well, through June anyway. Next week, we have the great Art Davis, who's a trumpet player, with Andy Brown, a fantastic guitarist, and Jim Cox, a great bass player. That will be next week, and on and on. And Judy Roberts after that. I won't bore you with all the details of shows you won't remember, but do take the cards. Do check out the website. We have a newsletter you can sign up for. What you're here for tonight, though, of course, is the great Howard Levy. I mean, this guy is, he's really something else. I come up at the end of the first set and do a little Q&A with the fellows, and we talk to them a little bit. I won't bore you with details now, but I will say that Howard musically has had a really profound impact on my life. I grew up playing the piano and started playing the harmonica as a little kid, and when I moved to town, I had this amazing run-in with Howard. I'll tell you about that later, but Howard really is a fantastic, fantastic musician and probably the world's sweetest guy. He's here with Larry Gray, who is an incredible bass player, and Howard's son, Miles Levy, who is a fantastic drummer. So we're in for a real, real treat. I'm not going to go on and on anymore. I'm going to turn it over to these fine gentlemen, but please give a nice warm welcome to Howard Levy, Larry Gray, and Miles Levy.
Falls over the crowd. Thank you very much. Thank you. Well, so this is a band that met in the recording studio. I have known and played with Larry for many years, almost as many years as I've known my son.
Actually, more.
But more years than I've played with him. Oh.
When is he born?
In 79.
We met in 76.
Okay, I've known Larry longer than my son has been alive.
There you go. There you go.
But one of the things that was interesting, I got Larry and Miles together with me in the studio. Just one of those things I thought would work, because they had never played together. And I thought, it's like a triangle with one open leg, you know? Like the two legs are connected, you know, legs, arms, whatever you call them, and there's one connection that hasn't been made. So if you're gonna do free improvisations with no preconception, it's interesting to do it with people who have never played together before. That last piece that we just played was a total free improvisation with no discussion.
Yeah.
Thank you. And it was very much like the first thing that we recorded in the studio, which is the first track of the CD over there. It's called The First 9 Minutes, and that's what it was. And then we played a bunch of other things, and some of them were very free, and then some of them actually sounded like tunes. And so we're gonna play a combination of free improvisations, some compositions of mine that I've played with Larry and Miles in separate groups, and some of the free improvisations that we made up that day. I transcribed parts of these, and we're gonna play one for you right now. And this one is called Octave Melody, because I played a melody in octaves. And I was fooling around with it while Miles and Larry were having a conversation, and I almost left that part on the recording. And I said, hey, let's play this. And we played this, you know. And we're gonna play it for you now, because I wrote out what I played. And then we take off and do other stuff.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. That's the second time we've played that. All right. And now I'm going to we're going to move along with the piece I wrote. I actually remember the date that I wrote this piece. It's unusual. Yeah. Sometimes I don't even remember writing a piece of music. It's like, gee, I wrote that? How did that happen? But I remember the date of this one because it coincided with the major life event. It's the day Miles was born. I saw it happen. I was there. I assisted. I it's like sort of like hockey. You know, you assist. Someone else actually scores, you know, and the puck, so to speak. It was good, right? And I was just so absolutely astounded, and I just had all these emotions going on. So I came home and sat at the piano and wrote this tune. And I wrote it, but his mom gave it the title. I said, "You can give it a name." You know, we gave him a name, but she can give the tune a name. And it's I didn't realize that someone else wrote a tune with the same name. You know. So, Miles, you right away started out in the world infringing upon someone's copyright indirectly. I'm sorry. Did Keith Jarrett write the other one, that other Moonchild?
King Crimson had one. There's a bunch
of them. Oh, there's a bunch of them. Damn. It's worse than I thought. So, this tune is called Moonchild. Thank you. Times when you're going to a recording studio, we had to wear headphones, unfortunately, because the harmonica is so soft, like no one could hear it without help. And so I said, "Yeah, let's check out the headphones and let's just play a blues." And I'm playing for a little while. And I said, "Boy, this is fun." So I kept playing, and it ends up it's the last track on the CD. So it's sort of default for musicians. Let's play a blues in F or blues in whatever. So I picked up this harmonica, and it's a blues in E flat and. The great Vaughn Freeman had just passed away a little while earlier, so I just called it Blues for Vaughn.
Larry Gray and Miles Levy. Thank you very much. And Steve Rashid, who makes this all possible. Give him a really huge round of applause. This is Evanston is, yeah, I'm glad I live here. And so that's the end of the first set, and I believe something's happening now, something unique and wonderful. And I'm supposed to talk into the other mic?
No, you can talk into that one. Oh, yeah, right.
Yeah, yeah.
You don't mind looking at my butt for a minute, do you? Okay.
And they can talk into your mic.
Yeah, I'll pass it around.
Yeah, I've said enough. Why don't you start out asking someone else a question? Like someone from the audience, like, where are you from? Missoula? Anyone here from Missoula? No, I don't think so.
Hi.
First of all, Howard, that was so cool when you transcribed the three improvisation and did it. I took the liberty during that last song to transcribe your solo as you were playing it. There it is.
Oh, yeah. I especially like the coda.
Yeah.
I think that's North Dakota. I'm not sure.
Oh. Wow, don't you wonder how many brains this guy has? Like, wow.
Who?
Ornette.
What?
He just passed. Ornette.
Oh, man.
Ornette Coleman just passed away.
Oh.
It said 2 hours?
Ornette Coleman is the main inspiration for a lot of the things that we're playing tonight. And I would just like to give him a big thank you wherever he might be.
Well, that kind of changes everything.
Sorry, I just
felt like... Well, usually I'm all jovial and... Ask some pithy questions. One of the questions I was going to ask maybe is pertinent in light of all the beautiful music that Ornette gave us. How beautiful is it to see father and son? Yeah. Isn't that great? Isn't that great? I've had... the distinct pleasure of oddly enough, my own son is also a drummer. I've had the distinct pleasure of performing with him, and I know it can allow you some closeness that you can't really get when you're talking. You know?
Yeah.
What do you think about that, Miles? Because I'm not going to be able to talk much more. Seriously, I mean, is it kind of?
Yeah. It's a great relief to not have to talk, and then. I don't know. I don't know what else to say. I bought on a laugh there.
I get that from my son too. It's part of the beauty of it. It kind of chokes me up. That was a great line. Miles, you just drove in from New York, yes?
Yes, I did. Yes, I did, Steve.
This is going to be a really long 30 seconds. Really long.
Now we break for commercial.
Yeah.
Are your feet tired? Try the new foot angel. Okay, anyway, yeah.
Oh, my God. Larry, you know, one of the really great things that I'm seeing as I'm watching you, and I don't do that much free improvisation, but when I'm watching you, it looks like it's like you're having so much fun. Like it's all done kind of with a, I mean, it's cerebral on one hand, and on the other hand, it's so just, it's almost, it's, you're, everybody's laughing. It's done all with a sense of humor. Am I right?
You're absolutely right. It's great. It's a lot of fun. I want to go back to the previous point and say that it's got to be really tough playing for your father, playing with your father, and then again, it's got to be really tough to be playing with your own child. So part of the fun I'm having, I mean, you're right, it's always fun to play with, you know, especially this kind of music for me, but and really it's all free in a certain sense.
Yeah.
You just have to keep certain forms. You just always, there has to be some kind of, you know, certain obligations, like the listener for one.
Sure.
But at any rate, I'm having great fun watching both of them rise to the occasion.
Yeah, and you know, that's a great point. I mean, even in the freest stuff, there's an agreement about something, right? Mm-hmm. Even if the agreement is happening in the moment, yeah. It's there. You're agreeing on stuff. Otherwise, it's just a mess, yes. Right?
That's right.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
Right. Yeah. Democracy in action.
That's right. That's right. They're all voting yeah. constantly.
Yeah.
Howard, did you when you decided to transcribe the piece that you transcribed, were you doing it because that one just turned out particularly, you just really liked the way that sounded after the fact, or?
Yeah, I mean, some of the things on the recording were totally free. And we'd say, like, why don't you start playing something, and then he'll play something, and then I'll play something. But some of them sounded like tunes with chord changes and charts and forms, you know? And so there are about four of those, and I transcribed them because they sound like tunes, you know? And they are tunes.
Right, mm-hmm. Right.
So that's why I chose those, that they sounded like, you know, tunes. And they felt like tunes while we were playing them. We were creating the forms together through these agreements from having a lot of experiences playing with a lot of different styles of music, a lot of different people. And like I said, it was the first time we played together. So there was that aspect of unpredictability about it, you know, that made everybody cooperate in a more conscious way, I believe.
And so when you recorded the CD, that was the first time the three of you had played together?
Yes.
Ever?
Yes.
And this is the second?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. How great is that?
Yeah, you should have heard Soundcheck. It was on. It's great.
Great stuff.
It's wonderful.
There's a question back there, my lovely wife. Yeah. Yes, Bea.
To answer your third question, yes. What brought me to New York?
Yeah, like what are you doing now that you're there? Yeah.
Well, I guess what brought me there was just a restless spirit and wanting a new adventure. As much as Chicago is awesome and I come back here and it's, not to get too heavy here, but, you know, I love it here and I always love New York too, so I have a dual city sort of love affair.
Yeah.
What do I do in New York? I'm trying to figure that out myself. But I keep busy.
Well, I was born in New York and grew up there. And I came to Northwestern in 1969. And right. And I learned how to play harmonica at a rally for the Chicago 7 during freshman orientation week. I've been carrying my harmonica around in my pocket. I was already like a good piano player, you know. I was playing jazz. I studied classical piano. I wasn't a music major, but I bent my first note after this rally, and it sort of, I got obsessed with playing the harmonica. And I moved back to New York for a few years, and then I came back out here, because New York in the early 70s was crazy. I wanted to get out of here, and then I came back here. I went, boy, it's kind of nice out here, you know. So I ended up staying for the last 43 years.
Wow.
And
just trying it out.
I mean, I love New York, and so it's a very interesting thing that he went there, because our both sides of our family, I'm divorced now, but his mom's parents also from there, and so he would go visit his grandparents there a lot, and so there was a reason for him to be there, not just like, I'm gonna have an adventure. It was a family connection as well. Yeah, so but I'm really glad that he lives in New York, because I think that New York imbues you with a certain kind of a spirit, and every place has its own ineffable, magical qualities that gets into your music if you're an improviser or a composer, or even just playing an instrument in different places, no matter what you play. You play differently when you're in different places. And I really hear that in his playing. That's one of the other reasons I really like playing with him. I think he brings that to here and to this.
Yeah. Hey, Howard, you and I have talked about this before, but for people who in the audience who are not harmonica players, the last thing I want to do is turn this into a lectern, but could you just give, I mean, there's a, right, I mean.
Oh, people there? Oh, sorry. Yeah.
But can you, the 10-hole harmonica is in a specific key.
Yes.
So any harmonica you pick, that's why there's so many harmonicas, because each one is in a different is in a different key, different tonal center. And in its basic form, when you inhale and exhale, you get just the notes of that key, and you can bend several of the notes fairly easily with moving your tongue inside your mouth and changing the shape, and get the note that's just lower than the note that would normally be played. That's what mortals do. And then Howard picked, and so they're by design, it's a very simple instrument, and it is missing some notes.
Yes, and they left the notes out on purpose, because the Germans who designed it put in the major scale in the middle, and the bottom, there's only the notes of the one chord and the five chord. So be able to play. Does anyone have beer steins here? Yeah. That's what it was designed for. And then it came to America, and black blues musicians realized that if you don't play it in the key of the exhale, if you play, for example, you could exhale, play Pop Goes the Weasel. You play that same rhythm on an inhale, you get a blues shuffle. And so that was kind of interesting, Mixolydian mode, for all you music majors here. And not only that, but all the notes that you need to bend for the blues are built in magically into this Bavarian instrument. So the Germans invented the world's greatest blues instrument without trying.
Yeah, can you believe that? How about that?
And then there are certain notes that you can't get just by this bending thing, and there are notes that weren't there. And as a piano player, I thought this was ridiculous. How could a musical instrument not have all the notes? And so I did a thing where you bend on the top by blowing, and on the bottom by drawing. And I thought, okay, my 18-year-old brain goes, what if you try to bend by blowing on the bottom? I just thought, yeah. And this other note popped up, and it was one of the missing notes. And I realized that if I did this backwards bending thing, I could get all the missing notes on the instrument, and there were six of them. So this is a C harmonica. It's just like same as the white keys of the piano. So. See, now you have a full three-octave chromatic scale.
And what I'm talking about.
So I was the first one to do that, and it was sort of lonely for a little while. And then other people started asking me, how do you do that? And I started teaching, and now it's become kind of a mainstream part of harmonica technique, so I can play in any key. It's all inside the mouth, and I visualize the piano keyboard in my mind to do it, which is how I play them together at the same time.
And because it's all happening inside his mouth, it's pure magic. It's not really happening.
No. I've got mirrors in there.
It's just phenomenal. Anybody have any quick questions? I want to give these guys a well-deserved break here, but yes, oh, yeah. Howard.
Can we have a break?
Where's the bathroom? Yes. Folks, please do stick around. We're gonna have another full set of music. And thank you for coming out, supporting live music here at Edmonton. And thanks to Howard, Larry, Miles for such a great evening.
And buy our CD.
Yes, by all means. They have the CD right here. You're welcome to come up and talk to these guys and pick up some
so
of the music,
no
take it home.
For me.
Ladies and gentlemen, as the fellows make their way back to the stage, let me just quickly remind you. First of all, thank you. Thank you all for coming here. This is so great. We have seen such a great increase in our audiences here, and it really pleases me. I cannot tell you. It's so great. Next week, we have the great Art Davis, who is a fantastic trumpet player. He'll be here with Andy Brown, who has played here at the Whiskey Lounge more than anybody. He's sort of everybody's favorite guitarist. And Jim Cox, wonderful, wonderful bassist. So, and they will be doing more traditional jazz. I tell you, one of the things I love about this series is, I mean, jazz is a huge boat. And I love the wide spectrum that is represented in Chicago in all these different subgroups of jazz and so expertly, and it's so great to have it. So next week will be something a little bit more traditional, Art Davis and Andy Brown and Jim Cox. And then the week after that will be Judy Roberts with her husband, Greg Fishman. And if you don't know Judy, you're going to want to be here for that. She is a fantastic pianist and singer, and she lived here in Chicago for many, many years, now lives in Phoenix primarily, and comes here for the summers. And so we're going to have her both this month and next month. She will be here. So that's the next couple weeks. But for now, there they are. Let's welcome back to the stage the incredible Howard Levy, Larry Gray, and Miles Levy.
Has lost a lot of weight.
The first tune is Grooving with Miles.
Yeah, it is. This first tune is, we named it after him, so we have no idea where he is. He's AWOL, and not sure what to do about that other than we could do our duet if you want to play piano. Start with that.
What's our duet?
You don't know what love is on piano? Do you want to play this keyboard? Probably not. We're going to give him another minute or two.
And, send it to the corner and make it play.
I mean, I have a feeling it's going to walk in.
We could play it on bass and harmonica.
Here he comes.
All right, so Miles was on the phone with somebody who was watching this online and told him, they're calling you to the stage. Thank you for that. Appreciate that.
Perfect. Jen knew it?
Yeah, she's watching the live. As our grandma and grandpa.
So you want to just do 8-bar intro, or you want to... Let's just do the ink.
So this is one of the ones I loosely transcribed and called it Groovin' with Miles. We'll be right back.
Larry Gray.
Yes, that's You Don't Know What Love Is, and we planned that, by the way. And before that was Giant Steps with a fake-out introduction of Take 5, because we played it in 5. So that's, because each word actually has 5 letters in it. I never thought about that before. And I never will again. So here's a tune that we didn't get to in the first half. And it's one, oh, did you ever get that music stand, Steve? Is there one?
I'll go get it. You want it? I'll get it.
Okay, I'll waste time while he's gone, because we're among friends here, and I just do want to let you know that some people do ask me where I'm going to be playing, and I guess I should talk on this mic because it's I'm supposed to. I do what I'm told, you know. It's, I'm going to be playing at Ravinia on June 20th as part of Prairie Home Companion. And that actually coincides very interestingly with this night, because the first, when we went and recorded, the reason why Miles came out was to play a Jewish wedding with me for the cantor who we play the holidays for. And so one day I played Prairie Home Companion, the next day a Jewish wedding, and the next day we went in the studio and recorded all this music. And so I think maybe that's part of the looseness of it, is that I had no, I hadn't been playing jazz, you know. I'd been playing, I called my, I was a Jutheran for 2 days. And coincidentally enough, the reason why Miles is here now and that we set up this concert is that we're also playing a Jewish concert for the same people up in Glencoe Highland Park, along with Larry on Saturday. Celebrating, I think, 25 years of this congregation in existence. So it's actually, you know, part of life. You know, like, I'm very, very lucky that I have this rich musical life that includes all these different styles of music. I'm open to them, and I take them in, and they come out slightly skewed, probably. So, yeah. And so after that, I will be playing 3 things around here in July with my band Acoustic Express. A thing in Wilmette on July 10th, and a thing in Glen Ellen on July 11th, and in Long Grove on July 5th. Some of them are duos with Chris Siebold, and one of them, the one in Wilmette, is with the band Acoustic Express, which had its start at Cafe Express in Evanston, sort of named after it. Yeah. So, oh, there's a music stand. I can see this. So this is another one that we played on the record. I improvised this, and I tried to write out the part that I improvised, and we're looking for titles. Miles named the CD First Takes, because everything on there was. And this one is called Urban Hoedown.
Is this about Richard?
One, two, one, two, three.
Thank you.
We're going to do another one of the, this is on, yeah. Well, it's all right. Another one of the transcriptions of one of the tunes, and it's kind of a jazz waltz. I call it speculation, because it was, we were kind of doing that, you know, and I dedicated it to the musical memory of Andrew Hill, who is a really brilliant, kind of underappreciated jazz pianist who recorded several really important albums for Blue Note in the 1960s that every jazz musician who's ever heard it remembers them. It was a huge influence on my hearing, and I mean all of us. That album, Point of Departure, was one of the greatest things anyone ever played. And so this one starts out with drums. I guess we didn't know what was going to happen. I said, why don't we start one out with drums? Thank you.
Larry Gray, Miles Levy. Thank you.
I think we're going to play another one, and let's play Chirinho and finish up tonight. Thank you.
Howard Levy, Miles Levy, and Larry Gray. How incredible. Can I just say, we've had full houses before. We've never had full houses stayed the entire night. So you all get gold stars. You get a gold star, you get a gold star, you go ahead. Thank you. Howard Levy, Larry Gray, Miles Levy. Unbelievable. Yeah. Thanks to you all for sticking around. We'll leave it to the theologians to figure out what happens next, but what a great way to send off Ornette Coleman. Huh?
And many thanks to this visionary gentleman right here.
Thank you all.